too much to go back and pretend. 'Cause I've heard it all before, and I've been down there on the floor. No one's ever gonna keep me down again. Whoa, yes, I'm wise, but it's wisdom for the pain.
Welcome to Girl Talk. I'm Regina Ayars, and my co-host is...
I'm Carol Voisin.
Girl Talk is a lively discussion of the opportunities, challenges, and successes of women in their daily lives. We interview women living in the Rogue Valley who are making a difference in our community. Today we have a guest who has been a champion of finding resources for those in our community who are in need. Her organization collects food, clothing, and furniture, and then distributes through existing nonprofits who provide direct services to those in need. So before we actually meet our guest, let's watch a clip of her talking about how she got Food Angel started. Why don't you tell me your name and organization?
Pamala Joy with the Ashland Food Angels.
And I think what we'd like to talk about today is how Food Angels came about.
Okay.
How did you have the idea, the thought, to even create something like this?
Okay. Well, it was, I didn't sit down and think I'm going to do this. It was a kind of organic development. In the mid-90s, I ran clothing exchanges for women, and there were a lot of clothing pieces left over. I wanted them to go to a good home, and somebody had told me about the Northwest seasonal workers. When I went there to donate the clothing, they asked, and they're in Medford, they asked if I would be willing to come once a week and bring some food from Ashland. That Ron from Geppetto's, which was a restaurant at that time, was donating 100 pounds of potatoes, and they didn't have any transportation. So I didn't see any reason not to, and started going once a week and taking them potatoes. And then I thought, this is not very much. They had like 300 or 400 families they were helping. So I began to think, well, where else could I get food for them? And I knew several bakers, and I went to my baker friends, and they were just throwing the old bread out and were happy to give it to me to take to the seasonal workers. And then I thought, well, if I go to two bakers, why don't I go to all the bakers since everybody seems to be throwing it out? And that's what I did. I went to every baker in town, and then every baker was willing to give me bread. And then at one point, I was dumpster diving behind the old camp wells thinking, well, maybe I could get some more stuff. And at a party, I met Tom Cantwell, the owner of the store, and I didn't tell him that I was dumpster diving, but I told him about what I was doing. And this was still in like 96, I think. It was still pretty early on in the program. And he said, well, come to the back door and I'll just give you stuff. And then it started from one day a week, him giving me a few boxes, or the store giving me a few boxes, to it rapidly went to 7 days a week, because they had stuff they were throwing away. They would rather go to people. And it was produce and boxed teas and cereals and everything that the store would have that they were passing on. And then when I started getting so much, I started thinking, well, where else could it go? And I thought of the senior center and Head Start and Uncle Foods, the free meal. And Uncle Foods at that time was getting no produce, no fresh food, all frozen food. So they were delighted to have the produce and the other stuff too, whatever I took them. And for a while, the senior center was receiving things. And Head Start, actually, parents from Head Start eventually started helping with Food Angels, because when Cantwell's closed in 2001, the end of 2001, that was just about the time when the market of choice was being built. So I went into the market of choice and told them what I was doing and asked if we could be their donation recipient of choice, because a lot of the other stores were giving already to Access. And because it's nearby and I was the first to ask, they said yes. So they are our biggest donor. So the main donors are the Market of Choice, the Ashland Co-op, and Shop and Cart. And then different bakers and various other smaller organizations.
And when did you found Food Angels? When did
you start going? So it was 95 or 96. Yeah.
Okay, so we're talking almost 20 years.
Over 20 years.
Over 20 years.
Yeah.
Yeah, 95, 96, you're right.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Well, great. So that is a great transition and segue. And we'll close with that, and then we'll hear about what's actually happening today.
Okay.
Thank you, Pamela.
Great. All right.
Our guest today is Pamala Joy. She's the founder and director of the Food Angels, as you just heard. And Pamela, I've heard about the Food Angels ever since I've been in Ashland. Could you just give us a hint or an idea about how you came up with that name?
Well, this is a little esoteric, but there are different times in my life where I just know something. Uh-huh. And I just knew that was supposed to be the name. It just came to me. And earlier on, people said, oh no, that's just a little too airy fairy or to Ashland or something. So we called it Food for People, which was a little more down to earth.
That was the name?
It was called Food for People, yeah.
Okay.
And then as those people moved on, I changed the name to what I wanted it to be. Because that's what I see these volunteers. They're all angels. Mm-hmm. And I think there are other food angels throughout the United States. We're the only Ashland food angels that I know, but there are other food angels if you look on the internet.
Uh-huh. Where did you get your logo from?
Well, the heart and wings is Sufi in origin, and the may all be fed is from John Robbins, who wrote Diet for a New America. Uh-huh. And he very much advocates a diet that allows there to be more food for everybody.
Mm-hmm. So this is Sufi?
I believe that's where the heart and wings originated from.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hmm. Very interesting.
Great. So tell us the things that you find most engaging. What keeps you going with Food Angels? You've been, you know, this has been going for at least 20?
Yeah, over 20 years.
Over 20 years? What keeps you energized?
It feels like I'm on a daily treasure hunt, for one thing. It's like we never know what's coming in any day, and sometimes it's quite exciting.
The day I was there, you got some delicious cherries.
Yes.
And you all had a little taste.
Yeah.
And said, oh, these taste good. So,
yeah.
Cherries.
And then, I did start the program so that food could go to people, but it was also that I noticed that there were two landfills that had just recently closed soon after I moved to Ashland, and that concerned me. So it was also to keep things out of the landfill that didn't need to be in the landfill, and usable food doesn't need to be there. Mm-hmm. And also we collected other things that would have been thrown away, like berry baskets for the farmers or plastic trays that could be reused. Mm-hmm. And so this combined dedication to keeping things out of the landfill and keeping them directed to people who could use them gives me great satisfaction. I mean, I've always been a very frugal person. I've always been somebody who likes to see things being used. I lived at the Fintorn community for 6 years in the 80s, and I was the one that found things for people. Mm. Somebody said, oh, I need a new winter coat. Oh, I need a suitcase. I'd go, oh, I'll find it, and I would, and it seems to be a gift that I have. Mm-hmm. And what I've focused on here in this valley is where is the best place something can go so that it it's really needed. So it can be used by people who really want it. Mm-hmm. So I've identified locations, like I know Maslow takes bedding as well as food, and the library takes books, most people know that. But a lot of people don't know mm-hmm. what to do with their cast off stuff. Mm-hmm. And I've made a science out of finding where can this thing best go. And mm-hmm. I love that, it's fun for me.
So we can drop off just about anything.
Well, you could, and but if everybody did that,
you will. That's what I'm saying. You will find
I'd
a place for it.
Overwhelmed.
Have you got some items at home?
I sure do. Well, and that's fine. I just don't want the whole town of Ashland
right.
dropping
yeah,
off.
Right.
I already work 7 days a week. So.
Oh my gosh.
No. So, but I would be happy if people called me and they'd say,
this
you know,
is
this is what I have. Where
okay.
I could take it because. Okay. Goodwill, unfortunately, is the only donation site in Ashland. There are more in Medford, like Salvation Army and St. Vincent de Paul and the ARC Center. And Goodwill gets overwhelmed with mm-hmm. stuff. So, unfortunately, a lot of the stuff ends up in the landfill because they can't deal with so much.
The free box is still open
one day a week. Just 1 day a week.
Right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And in terms of clothing, we send clothing to the community meal, Uncle Foods, mm-hmm. and then I just found out about a free box at Wellsprings. And a lot of people who live down there are right on the edge, and so we're starting to take things down there.
Mm-hmm. That's good. So, and where else do you take clothing?
Well, not just clothing, but I just sent a big pile of old rugs and towels to the animal shelter for the dogs.
Nice.
So. You know, rugs that are tattered that nobody mm-hmm. wants to use anymore. What do you do with them? They can go and be
Absolutely.
Used as bedding for the animals. So, we send food during the year to Head Start once a week.
Weird.
And that's not to the Head Start on Walker.
On Walker.
And that's not for them to use there in the building, but it's for the families to pick up and take home. Because they have their own food that they serve
right.
to the kids there. But a lot of those families are you know, mm-hmm. struggling, and the take-home food is helpful to them. And in addition, I worked in conjunction with the family advocate there and helped families learn, this is a rutabaga, or this is a fennel, and this is what you can do with it, new foods for them. Uncle Foods and the new Friday free meal.
Tell mm-hmm. us what Uncle Foods is. So
so it's a long-term, much longer than Food Angels. I think it's been going 35 mm-hmm. years mm-hmm. or so. Community free meal, open to everybody. It's not just for the homeless mm-hmm. or you don't have to be. You can mm-hmm. be of any station in life and just mm-hmm. go. It's for the whole community. Mm-hmm. And I actually started giving to them very early on in the 90s, and they didn't have any fresh food coming in.
Wow.
And a lot of what I was collecting was perishable, was mm-hmm. fruits and vegetables.
Mm-hmm.
And so they were delighted because they were getting frozen food mm-hmm. from the university, but they didn't have any fresh food. So now they get tons of fresh food, mm-hmm. and we start collecting for them a little bit on Friday, and then a lot on Saturday, and a lot on Sunday and Monday,
mm-hmm.
and then the meals on Tuesday afternoon mm-hmm. at the Methodist Church.
It's a real, it's delicious.
Oh, it is.
Maren
yeah.
Faye, she does a wonderful
meal. She is amazing, and she and I work closely together.
And do you deliver, or does she pick it up?
She has a driver that comes and picks it up, and she picks up some, and
mm-hmm.
and then we deliver a lot to the food bank that holds it for her over the weekend.
Oh, okay.
And we deliver to the food bank 7 days a week.
Wow.
Yeah.
And then there's a Friday meal now, Jason mm-hmm. and Vanessa do mm-hmm. in Pioneer Hall or one of the parks, and we give a lot of food to them for that meal.
Mm-hmm.
And they also give out the handout food in mm-hmm. the park, so we give them a lot of what I call hand-to-mouth food
mm-hmm.
that can just be handed out.
So how many volunteers do you have that help you?
Well, now I have around 25.
25?
In the past, I've had more, but mm-hmm. It's a lot of work having more volunteers.
I think we've got a clip of one of your volunteers,
one of my
Scott.
Best volunteers.
I know.
Yeah.
Can we roll that clip of Scott Reeder? He's fairly new.
Yeah.
Mm. Great. Why don't you tell me your name and how you got involved with Food Angels?
My name is Scott Reeder, and I volunteered back in September as I moved back to Ashland, and I wanted to give back to my community.
And what are you doing here today on Tuesday? What happens on Tuesdays?
I'm a sorter. Food gets brought in here. We sort the food, and then we distribute it to Marin, who does the JCFC. I think it's JCFC. But she does the meals on Tuesday.
Right, that's Uncle Food's Diner.
Uncle Food's, yeah. Okay, I got that backwards.
Right.
Yeah. And then we send the rest out to food bank.
To the food bank?
Yeah.
Okay. So people bring food here today, and you sort it, and then it gets delivered. The perishables get delivered today.
Yeah, we actually go collect it.
Oh, you go collect it, so people don't even have to deliver.
No.
And is that what the gentleman that left in the truck was doing?
Yes, it is.
Okay, he's going to pick up. Great. Well, have you enjoyed your experience so far? You haven't been here quite a year.
It's the most wonderful place to be a part of as a volunteer.
Great, great. That's a great way to end your little interview here. Thank you.
Well, Scott is certainly a fascinating individual and I bet a wonderful volunteer.
Yes.
Would you tell us a bit about how you finance Food Angels?
Well, in the beginning, I financed it. And in fact, the first 5 years, I did all the work as well.
Oh, wow.
With the help of my teenage daughter. And then it took me a while, but I started asking people for help. And then in 2003, I applied for a community grant from the co-op. So we've gotten a small grant from the co-op every year. And then there's this wonderful program that Peace House sponsors called Empty Bowls.
Oh,
and
yes.
We get some money from, that as well. Mm-hmm. Yes, yes. Actually a larger grant from them. Mm-hmm. And a student 1 year helped put together a program where we put little donation boxes around town. And so people put pennies and quarters in there, and so we get a little money from that. Mm-hmm. And then I have a yard sale at least once a year, and that brings in a bunch of money. This year did very well. And
do you get a grant from the city?
No, I've never.
You've
asked.
Never applied. You've never applied.
No,
but that's a possibility.
I'll help you apply.
Okay. Oh, yeah. I would love to.
Okay.
Yeah, that
I'll
would
help
be wonderful.
You with that.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Maybe I can phase out the yard sales. There's so much work.
They are a lot of work.
But I do meet a lot of people, and that it's always a good
that's
outreach
good.
To the community.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. I'll definitely help you with that.
Okay. Great.
What about your volunteers? What do they get out of this?
My volunteers range in age from, I think the youngest one now is 18, and I've had volunteers into their 80s, but now it's mostly mid-60s. So there's retired people
Sounds
and students,
good to me.
People who are unemployed or underemployed.
Uh-huh.
So they're people mostly on the edge as well. Mm-hmm. So in addition to the joy of being part of a close-knit organization, little community within the community, they get to take home food as well, some of them, it helps very much.
Wow.
I had years I had a disabled couple who worked with me, and they said it made all the difference to their lives that they could take home food.
Mm-hmm. I think I've got another clip when I was down there on Tuesday of a couple of your other volunteers, so maybe we could roll the unloading video that I took.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, while you were unloading food that had come in,
so
or I think that somebody had picked up.
Do what you want to do.
What's in the grand view box?
Cherries.
Cherries?
Organic. And they are organic, but they need sorting. There's a few of them. They have a little bit of more. But they're in the other one.
So, that's impressive.
Yeah,
that's impressive. Nice.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay.
Terry, put this on top of it. Can we juggle one more? Two more?
That's our frame.
Can we put one more on there? I'll see.
Let's make a tip over.
Look, in front
That'd
of you.
That'd be a great
that's
shot.
Open.
Yeah, that's going to spill.
Be very careful.
Okay. Move that over there, and let me put this on top. Move this over to you. Yeah. There you go.
It's getting to be about a 300 pounder.
You can divide it up too.
It's like Tower of Babel.
Or Jenga.
It is 300.
Yeah.
Okay.
Whoa, no way.
Okay.
Oh, that top.
Well, Pamala, you have some really good volunteers, obviously.
Could you get one question off of that video?
Okay.
What is the scale for?
Well, I was given a national award by E-Town that comes out of Boulder, Colorado, some years ago. They pick one person every week across the country who they think is doing something good. But they wanted to track what they were doing, what we were doing, and they said, well, how many pounds a week? And I had no idea. So we started weighing the food, and what we found is we give away 250,000 pounds of food or more every year.
Whoa.
And probably more than that in clothing, because the clothes are so heavy. But I had no idea until we started weighing it.
And that's how you get grants.
That's the kind of information that's really good information that people want.
Yeah. Yeah.
Can you tell us a bit about the farmers?
So I've always made friends with farmers, and I had already some farmer friends, and they were happy to donate to this program that the food could go out to people who needed it. So Fry Family Farm has been consistently part of that program, and Whistling Duck for a long while, Barking Moon, Blue Fox. There are a number of farmers that every week we go to the end of the Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday farmers market, and they always give us something to take back. Most of it goes to the food bank.
Oh, that's a good time to go at the end of a
Yeah, because they
markets.
Know what they don't want to take
exactly.
home. Yeah.
And how many freezers do you have in your storage area?
We don't really have a freezer. We don't really freeze the stuff. We mostly deal with produce.
Right. Okay.
So we do have canned and boxed food, but we mostly are perishable food.
Perishable.
So I raised some money locally a few years ago and built like what we call the cool room. It's not a walk-in fridge, but it's as close as we could come to it by having a large air conditioner with a small space. And we put the food that's being held in there until we can get it to the walk-in fridge at the food bank.
That's what I was wondering.
Yeah. I've got a clip of some of the really of the produce that's came in that day on Tuesday. You want to run that so you can see some of the types of products that are coming in, and then they're delivered to the food bank and to
Uncle Foods. Yeah.
So have we got that clip?
She doesn't use sprouts. It can be composted, this. And a little pickle. I think we could give it to food bank. If it's...
Terry's already gone.
Yeah, but you have all these other things. Yeah, you're right. Well, I don't know if you'll go back or not.
He kind of got out of here fast.
Yeah, he was in the middle. I mean, everything was in the middle of stuff. Who knows? That looks like a nine.
And normally what you'll see here is there'll be stacks of food to go out. Boxes, crates, great. And they come pick it up for us. The only people we actually like deliver to is food bank. The rest come here.
So Pamala, you have a major operation here. You have a call to action for people. Could you just tell those who are watching what you would like to say to them?
Well, if people have gardens or fruit trees that you don't know what to do with the extra fruit and produce, please donate it to the food bank. If you can't get down to the food bank because that's on the edge of town, you could come to the Food Angels. And my phone number is 541-482-5330. You can call me. There's also a neighborhood harvest gleaning project. So rather than let the food go to waste, get it out to people who can use it. Mm-hmm. Also, I'm looking for volunteers. If anybody wants to help in this organization, I'm always open to new volunteers. Or financial contributions are also wonderful.
So your website, if somebody goes to your website, what are they going to see there?
They're going to see what we do and who are our sponsors or our donors and how they can volunteer if they would like
to
volunteer.
Okay, so that's another way that they can get in touch with you is to go to the website.
And it's ashlandfoodangels.org.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm-hmm. Very good. So is there anything else you would like to share with us that we may not have asked you that...
Well, I have something. You have a different persona, we understand. Would you like to tell us just a little bit about your professional acting?
Well, and that's actually part of why I do this, because for years I was a traveling clown and mime, and I had a really wonderful life traipsing around Europe, teaching and performing. And when I left Europe in 1990, I said that I want to do something now that's service oriented. Mm-hmm. And so that was a real change in my life. Not that the clowning didn't bring something to people, of course, but this is a different aspect of serving our community.
Thank you for your service.
Absolutely.
I mean, I think it's amazing what you do.
Thank you.
Everyone knows that where food is available for people, it's the angels are behind it, and you. So I just want to say thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for being on the show today.
Yes.
But we've run out of time, Carol.
We have,
and
we have volunteers too.
Yes.
And I want to thank them. Wanda, Alex, Gary, John, Biome, Bob, and Lynn. Thank you so much. We wouldn't be able to have this program without you, so thank you very much.
And Girl Talk can be seen on Rogue Valley TV Channel 15 on Ashland Home Net or on Charter on Channel 182. And our program is on twice a week. It is on at 3 o'clock on Saturdays and then at 6:30 on Thursdays. So we're also can be heard on KSKQ Radio, where we started Girl Talk. And that is noon on Sundays at 89.5 FM. Broadcasting from Ashland, Oregon. So thanks for joining us today, and we hope that you learned something new, and come back and see us again soon. Thanks. Bye.
Bye-bye.